Hello and welcome to Women in Post, a podcast and web series for Women in Post Production by Women in Post Production. Today on the show, we'll be speaking with Ellen.
It's amazing what you can do and how you can make people feel and evoke emotions. And that's why my entire business name, the premise of it is, what story will you tell?
Well, how about we start out by you just telling us a little bit about yourself and how you got started in post-production?
Okay, so I'll start off with my name. I'm Ellen Morningstar. I'm the owner and operator of Morningstar Films. I feel like everybody starts off chasing what they love in the same form or fashion. I've always loved. That's how we always started off. I've always loved film. I've always loved editing. I've always loved this. But I've honestly always loved film to the point it was a problem in my childhood. Every weekend, my parents had to force me out of the house just so I would stop watching movies. And growing up where I grew up in a very, very small farming town in Illinois, and I'm a farmer's daughter, so that adds to it a bit. It was never really an attainable dream because everyone was just, movies is Hollywood, and Hollywood's California. I'm a small town girl. There's no way it's ever going to happen. So I didn't ever chase that dream. And it wasn't until I was in college, I was a collegiate athlete, and I was injured really bad, and I couldn't play anymore. And it was like, I honestly thought my whole life would just be volleyball, and it wasn't. So I had to start making some things work in order to have the life that I wanted to have. And it ended up in me chasing a marketing career for about 6 years, which was awful. And I realized I just could not do it. I could not work in corporate America. And I saved up, and I put myself through film school. And took a 2-year hiatus of no work, and I just put myself completely through school. And then as soon as I was done with school, I just dove full time to try and do any work I could. I started off in weddings, and then we moved to Oregon. My husband and I moved to Oregon, and I am so busy. I can't complain, but I am so busy now. Commercial work. I thought I would be in the wedding circuit and remain in there, but I am just commercials and events and promotional, and it has just taken off from there. I'm having a hard time hanging on.
Wow. Do you have employees? Do you work by yourself? How does that look?
It's just me as of right now. Eventually I would like to get an employee. At the moment I'm kind of hiring my husband. He's doing the business side. He's managing all of my QuickBooks and my expenses and helping me draft up all my contracts that need to be drafted up. Just so I mean, I was running out of daytime between the filming and the editing and then getting home in 3 hours of just sheer business log. I had no time to finish edits at some point. Mm-hmm. So it's just me as of right now. Eventually I would like to get an editor on board, either an editor or a camera person. Just somebody I can send out if I can't be, I can't be at two places at once. Mm-hmm. It'd be nice to not have to turn down jobs because I can't be in this town when I'm already in the town next to it filming that day. Uh-huh. Maybe in 2 years that'll probably come to fruition. I'm hoping anyways.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about how you made that transition from weddings, because I feel like a lot of people start in weddings into commercial work. What did that entail? You know, what was your success strategy, I guess?
So I was originally based out of Montana when I started my business, where my husband's from, and I based my whole wedding business out of there, and I live by Glacier National Park, which is a huge wedding destination. So for me, the business just made sense. You know, get to know some photographers, start throwing wedding filmmakers, because there's really not a lot around. I mean, it feels like the market is becoming super saturated as of late. But the reality of it is, I live here in Central Oregon, and there's a couple of big towns next to me. And there's really 2-3 maybe good wedding filmmakers. So it's kind of an untapped potential around here. But I started wedding filmmaking as the idea of, it's like birth and funerals, birth and death, right? It's just like everyone's always going to get married. Everyone's going to die. So I can either hit a wedding market or a funeral market. And I went the wedding way. When we moved to Oregon, I lost that, all of that clientele that I had. I lost my photographer connections. I didn't have any here. This is a really tiny town that I'm living in. So there's maybe 2-3 photographers, and they're not booking out high paying clients like I was in Montana. So I decided I was going to kind of step away from weddings and see what else I could chase, so I don't have to go work another 5 to 9. And the office that I'm sitting in right next door is a coffee shop, and they had a summer event. And I asked, I met with the coordinator, and I was like, can I come film this event for free? And you guys can use the film for marketing purposes and just credit me. I'm trying to build my business here. And I did this one free video, and it has exploded ever since.
Wow.
One promo film for free. And then from that, I booked 3 more jobs. And then from those jobs, booked 3 more jobs. And I didn't know anybody here. The only person I knew here was my husband, who I moved here with. So mm-hmm. I just had to find a way. So I talked to my real estate agent, and I was like, what's a big event around here besides what I had already filmed? And she's like, the rodeo is huge. So I snuck into the rodeo for 3 days and filmed it behind the scenes.
You snuck in?
I did. Well, I paid, but you're not really supposed to film or photo unless you have a press pass. And I did not have that. So I just kind of snuck between all the photographers and just was shoulder to shoulder with them. I'm like, I don't think anyone's going to notice that I'm not supposed to be here now.
That's so awesome. What a rebel.
Well, my husband always tells me, he's like, don't ask for permission, just ask for forgiveness. Mm-hmm. And I did it, and I made this awesome film. And that film is just every time they post it, it's just 10,000, 11,000, 12,000 views. It's just up and up and up and up and up. And now we're in the works of, they want to buy the film from me. So something I did completely for free in order to get my name out is now paying me money.
Wow. That's so cool. So where did you post it? Where did they post it when you first came up with it?
About a month after the rodeo, I finally got to sit down. I was traveling for weddings last summer. So as soon as I got back home from a wedding in Montana, I sat down. I did it a month after the rodeo and just put it on Facebook. Didn't tell anybody that I was producing this, creating it. And I was just like, here you guys go. And I tagged them. And then they were just like, holy crap, who are you? Where did you go? Can we use this? I was like, yeah, use it. Just give me the credit. I mean, it's a free film. Just do what you got to do. And it's so funny. They used that film. It was 3 weeks ago. I was just filming an event for them. It was a 75th anniversary. So they had a gala. And they asked me to film the event gala, but they also opened up the gala with that film. So I was like, that's cool. And in just a year, I've been here a year, and I've been able to hustle my way through, even breaking some rules. Long run.
What kind of camera did you use to do that?
So I started Canon. I started on Canon and I switched over to Panasonic. I went on a trip to the Moab in Utah after a Friendsgiving, and I just wanted to make a fun little film. And I've been testing out new gear, and I refused to spend $1,500 on a piece of equipment that I've never touched. So I rented a Sony before. I did not like it. And then I rented the Panasonic GH5. And I was just blown away by, it's terrible low light camera, but when the lighting's perfect, like the quality that you get out of this camera for under $2,000 just blew me away. 4K, it's gorgeous. Uh-huh. So now I'm shooting on a Panasonic GH5, a Panasonic GH5S, and eventually I'm going to pull the trigger on the fancy new S1H, but I can't just drop $8,000 right now on a whole new system. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I shoot Panasonic, and I've noticed around here, my competitors, I'm kind of the only one. A lot of people around here, especially in Bend, the biggest city next to us, are all Canon, or they're shooting cinema cameras. And I'm just kind of like this little old DSLR mirrorless chick hanging out in the back.
Oh, I love me some good mirrorless cameras. Okay, I'm going to try to screen share your clip right now.
There's a real enjoyment and satisfaction gained by going out and making your own personal discoveries. We ain't got a damn thing to lose, 'cause we're all living like rebels every day and every night. It can see we're dancing with the devil, but we got nothing to hide, nothing to hide. We can't tame this fire inside.
I just love that. Those tree transitions. Oh my gosh.
That's a local YouTuber here in Central Oregon, and he makes his living off of YouTube. He is an overlander, which is not hardcore off-roading, but he takes access to full public lands here in Oregon and makes films about them. And he's created routes that other overlanders from all across the country have come and done. And he reached out to me and was like, I need your help with something. I'm trying to make a documentary, a short documentary about me, but I obviously can't record it myself. And he's like, plus you can do more cinematic-y things when I'm just a vlogger. It's like, so can we, he's very upfront. I can't pay you, but if you're interested in this, like taking this on, like I really just want to have you do it. So I was like, absolutely. We all need passion projects between the whole workflow. So we actually went out and filmed that in 2 days. We filmed it in two locations here in Central Oregon and, well, both Central Oregon. One was in the mountain chain here and then one was out in the middle of the desert, in the middle of nowhere. And it's a short doc. I think we capped it at 10 minutes long. We just hit the 10-minute mark on it. But it is basically his life story about how he became doing what he's doing today. And it's a very emotional story. He gets very, very vulnerable in it about his struggles and what it's that he's just... He feels more comfortable being out there in the middle of nowhere than he does around a crowd of people. Mm-hmm. And he's just so grateful that he has all these supporters that are helping him live this dream, which I relate to because I have a huge backing of people who support my film career. So it was just, it was very interesting. And I wanted to make him look vulnerable, but also strong, because I feel like those two go hand in hand. So we talk about, before we get to that cinematic sequence, we talked up to that about why he does what he does, his little background, and that he can live out here and he can be okay. And so I just wanted to add in there like 30 seconds of just him looking really freaking cool in what he does. And it kind of goes on from there. He's also a very, very well-established photographer. He's worked for Wrangler and Pendleton, and they've hired him to go out and do things while he's on his trips and just, you know, hey, take some cool pictures of our jeans and our whiskey and those neat things. But yeah, that scene, I won't lie, I cried like 20 times trying to get it to work and put it together until I could finally make something that just went with the music and went with the view and all of that just natural lighting that came through. Like that, yeah. That one scene with the lighting through the chainsaw where it just boop. Oh my goodness.
How many times did you have to try that before you got it to pop like that?
Twice. Wow. Twice. There was once I was actually went handheld for those. I got off gimbal, went handheld. And I saw it once when I wasn't even trying to get it. And I just saw like, it just caught the very bottom. And I was like, keep sawing. And then I finally got it to where it just hit that perfectly. Uh-huh. And, a lot of that, I won't lie, a lot of like the stuff we film, I mean, I work very hard on composition and I always shoot in how I'm going to sequence my edits. So if I'm doing a wide, I know if he's a wide of him cutting wood, I need to get a close of his hands on the axe hitting the wood, him splitting the wood just to build it so much easier when it comes to post. But so much of that out in the woods was just film what I saw and hope for the best, which is not any advice I would give anybody. We didn't have an idea of a story going into it. So we were just filming what we saw and what came to light. We didn't plan any kind of pre-production in this. Mm-hmm. Went out to complete documentary style and just documented it all. And fortunately, we were able to come out with some really cinematic things.
Did he just say whatever came to his mind, or did he like have a script or?
No, I interrogated him. At least that's what we're not calling it. He doesn't call it interviews. He said Ellen interrogated me for 5 hours one evening, which I did. we had talked, we didn't do any kind of interview the first day. I wanted to feel him out, just have conversations with him so he could get really comfortable with me. And then that second day we sat down and actually did an interview. And I made him answer the hard things. There's that interview, 4 hours. We probably got 4.5 hours, 30 to 45 minutes of that was him just saying, that's too hard of a question.
And really? Then,
yeah, I can't answer that. That's too hard. And I wouldn't let him not answer it.
Wow, I'm going to get your questions.
I just stared at him. I'm like, you have to answer this. You can't ask me to make you a film about being vulnerable and you're not going to be vulnerable with me. It's like, we're not moving on from this.
Wow.
He eventually broke down, and plus a little bit of whiskey always helps. So got him to really start talking about the deep stuff. And then once we did, and he helped me edit a couple of times, he came over and I would just kind of show him where I'm going with this because it's his story and I want to do justice. Mm-hmm. And we're not getting paid. I'm like, we both have to work on this, man.
It's just all me. And sit down and start cutting.
No, I actually built out the whole interview first, and I spaced it exactly how I wanted it to, with sound and music, and that way I could start filling in the B-roll on top. And then once he just sat down and listened to the whole interview, how I cut it out, he was like, okay, I'm done. Bye. You've got this. I don't need to be here. Uh-huh. He finally started to realize, he's like, okay, I'm glad you actually did interrogate me. He's like, those questions make a difference whenever you're sitting there just being like, that's really hard and I don't want to talk about it. And then finally do. Mm-hmm. That's pretty neat.
That's amazing. So is there something that you learned during this project that maybe you hadn't encountered before?
I learned how difficult it is when you're working. And it's so weird because weddings are personal, but when it comes to somebody's story, basically their biography, it's hard not to get completely emotionally invested in it. And I feel like everybody in post-production does it. We overthink everything, every little cut, every little word, every little pause between a word. It's just like, is that too long of a pause? As if you were going to be like, oh, that was half of a second too long. They're going to hate this because of it. But I just really learned that I had to turn down the noise of what anybody else is going to think about it and just focus on him. Mm-hmm. And how to bring this to life. And whenever I finally, and it took weeks for me to just tune down everything else that I was worried about, tune down about his YouTube subscribers not liking it, tune down about my following not liking it. I mean, any film festivals that we're going to pitch it to, just I had to stop worrying about that and just do his story justice. And I didn't realize how bad I was at that until I started doing this project.
Wow.
Like how just outward influences have against the decisions that I make. And the reality of it is like, I know that I'm a good film editor and a good filmmaker. So I don't know why I'm so worried about what the prosumer is going to think, when really the consumer is what I need to just have involved in this edit. But he is my main story, not what anybody else's comments are going to be about it, which I think is hard. It's hard to overcome.
Yeah, I think there's always going to be kind of like this fear of failure, no matter how far we get in our careers, right? We're always wondering what other people will think of our work, because it's kind of very personal. Like, we do this work for other people, but like, we pour ourselves into it.
Yes. Right? We put everything we love on the line, and having that be rejected is the worst feeling ever.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Okay, so with that in mind, I mean, is there something, do you have experience with like getting that real rejection, not just like worrying about it, but like receiving it? Has that ever been a thing for you?
Yes. This was actually a couple of months ago. I was hired, and I can't say names. I was hired to do some political campaign filmmaking. And this person who was running for a local, like a state office here, she had asked me if I would just kind of make this, you know, short and sweet little thing to promote on Instagram and to Facebook. And I was like, yeah, absolutely. And I did the best of my ability. And this is when I realized it's really hard to make something for a client when the client doesn't like the way that they look or the way that they view themselves. There's no way that you can be successful in that situation. But that was the first film that I ever did where it was completely rejected.
Wow.
On aesthetics, it was 30-second clip, but on the aesthetics, how it looked, how it was told. And I was just like, I was very upset for about 2 weeks. I was just down in the dumps about it. And then I realized it's really nothing that I did. It's just how that person, they don't like the way that they look or the way that they're viewed, but I can't make somebody morally different than they morally are. Mm-hmm. And that's when I decided I will no longer ever do campaign filmmaking, any kind of political filmmaking. Because I can't lie about the person that you are, but it can make you the best looking person that I can. And it was still just rejected on those grounds.
Yeah.
Which sucked. That was like the first real rejection. That's not what we wanted. That's not what we like. And then that was it.
Wow. And so did they pay you?
They did. They paid me. They paid me for the work. And I even offered in the contract, I had multiple revisions, because those types of things always take revisions. Mm-hmm. I think I offered 3 revisions free of charge, and they wouldn't even do a revision.
Wow.
I know.
That's so bizarre. Like, they just decided they didn't want to do a video at all?
I have no idea. I completely separated myself from it and started chasing other work after it. And it's just like, oh, that kind of sucks. But it was like a learning curve for me that you can't please everybody, mm-hmm. but you have to realize you're going to please more people than you're going to not please people. And the 80-20 rule of filmmaking, I just apply that to everything in life. 80% of my clients are going to love the work and love the product. 20% are just not. And I have to be okay with that because that 20% is not going to drown me as a business.
Right, right. And for your business, what would you say like is the number, the percent of time you spend like finding your next client or to the percent of time you spend like building out that project or ending it?
Okay. So, well, that's kind of weird. It just depends on the project. Like right now I'm working on a big commercial project for it's corporate technically, but it's paying me for 4 months. I'm filming from January until it's done in May. In that I don't have to take on any other work right now. That is completely supporting me for those 4 months. But what's neat about this project is I'm going into other businesses and filming other businesses for it. And with those businesses, once they see this little footage, these little sneak peeks I'm making, they want to hire me. Mm-hmm. So realistically, I honestly think I'm not going to have to chase down work for at least a year after this.
Wow. So how did you find that first, the corporate client?
Funny, through the political person that didn't like what I did.
Oh my gosh.
Didn't like what I did, but they still recommended me, which I can't complain about. And I've been working with, this big not industrial, they kind of push industry, but this, I guess it would be more of a PR company. And they wanted me to create this film to bring big industry to like Central Oregon. So we're going out and we're filming 3 to 4 days a week, which is a lot of fun. I mean, I got to ride on an old train the other day, which I never thought I would do in a million years.
Like a rusty old locomotive type?
Yes. Yes. It was awesome. I got to hang off the side of it and everything.
That's so cool.
It was fun. So, it depends. And when I'm not super, super busy, I'll panic. If I'm not busy, if I'm not so busy that I'm complaining that I'm busy, I start to panic. And then I realized it's totally okay to not be busy. Because when I first moved here, I was chasing weddings really, really, really hard. And I'm still chasing weddings because I just love wedding filmmaking. But I'm just not getting the inquiries that I thought I would. And I'm actually, I was talking to my husband about that the other night. I was like, I'm actually okay with the fact that I don't have every weekend booked this summer. Mm-hmm. It doesn't bother me. I can finally take a breather and go on a vacation or go do something and not just be filming and editing and filming and editing.
Yeah.
We're going to 10 meetings a week, which I swear I have all the time. I can't be productive if I'm in meetings, guys.
Right. Okay. So what is the hardest choice that you think you've ever had to make in your film career?
Goodness, to pursue it at all. Right when we moved to Oregon, I got sick, which I wouldn't really consider sick, but we noticed things were happening to my body from years ago. And since I played college sports, it was always arthritis or this or that, or you're just sore because you did something. And then we started to realize something is definitely going on. I'm 28, almost 29. If I have severe arthritis at 29, something is happening here. And so right when we moved here, noticed some things were going on. I was really stressed. We were in the process of buying a house. I was in the process of starting this business in a new state with no connections. And I thought I was diagnosed with an incredibly rare autoimmune disease. And then when you start to learn about what it does, I mean, it kills people. Mm-hmm. So we had to really figure things out. Like, is the stress of starting a business worth what it's going to do to my body? And how do we balance that? And the terrible and great thing is there are no cures for autoimmune diseases. They can put you on medications, but those medications cause other diseases like cancer, and the list goes on. So I decided to just take the more homeopathic route and changed how I ate, changed what I did, tried to learn how to not be as stressed, which is easier said than done. And I've been able to maintain, which is nice, because we were really afraid for a while that I was going to lose the function of my hands. So when it gets really, really bad, my hands are not functional. I can't hold a pen. I can't write a list. Can't even hold a camera or a gimbal when things get bad. But things haven't been bad. I was diagnosed over a year ago, and I maybe have had two times here or there when it was just like, all right, take 2 weeks off, take a break, decompress before I lose the function. Because anytime I have what they call flare-ups, it causes permanent damage to whatever part of my body is having the issue. So when I have issues in my hands, I'm causing permanent damage to my hands, to maybe one day not be able to open up, you know, my pointer fingers or grab something. Mm-hmm. Which is scary at 29, but it also just made me push harder. Because I'm just like, nothing is guaranteed. And it sucks to get any type of diagnosis. But that was the biggest challenge of, is pursuing what I love worth what it could do to me long term if I don't take care of my health? Or can I find a way for the two to coexist? And so I found a way. And I can also say I'm happier filming than I would be working in a job like I was. And I think the stress of the past job is what triggered everything to come to. And now that I'm doing what I love, it's just, which is still stressful. I mean, it has its moments where I'm just like, I don't know how I'm going to finish today in order to start tomorrow. But even in the end of it, I'd rather deal with having a painful hand every now and then than just not pursuing it because of the fear of what's going to happen.
It sounds like you know some good ways to de-stress. Do you maybe sharing a couple of those with us?
My biggest thing is working on a passion project. So when I'm creative, and if I'm not editing, I feel like I'm not doing something. And so I either go out and just shoot, because I do like photography, but I don't pursue it professionally. So I'll either go out and I'll photograph some stuff or go take my friends on a photo shoot just to be creative, but have no pressure on it. Mm-hmm. No clients' needs. And even the short documentary, which was incredibly stressful, it brought me so much joy. And those little lights where it did just start flowing how I needed it to flow. And then, of course, it would stop and I'd be like, once from my computer out the window. So how I de-stress is I pursue a passion. That way, if I need to take a break from editing, but I don't want to stop the flow of what I'm doing on my computer, I'll just open up that other project and I'll cut through it and I'll look through it for a little bit and then I'll go back to the work. But it just refreshes my mind. Because when you're staring at a project, one project for so long, you become completely numb to it. Mm-hmm. And so that's the best way I found to de-stress. And then of course, I mean, just the normal, I'll go hang out with friends on a weekend. I'll give myself a weekend off or a Monday and a Tuesday off if I have to work Saturday and Sunday. Mm-hmm. And then just, I find really good ways to balance it out. And I'm an outdoors person, so I like to go out. I live up on the side of a mountain, which is why I'm in town talking to you, because I get no internet up there.
Wow, oh my gosh.
So I can just go out in my backyard and just go get lost for a couple hours and not have to run into another person or anybody else and just go out and back and don't have to worry about anything.
That sounds incredible.
It is. It's nice.
So here's, if you have no internet where you live, do you work in town or do you use, what editing software do you use?
So I'm on Premiere. I use Adobe Suite, but I have satellite internet. It's just not good.
Okay.
So when I have to upload big files, I just let it run all night when we're asleep. So that way when I get up, that 8 hours of upload time is already done and I'm ready to go and start the day.
Gotcha.
Nice. As far as downloading goes, if I have some big stuff I need to download, I come into town. I'm in a coworker's office right now. So she's just like, go take my office for the day. And I'll just come in here and use her internet and get stuff downloaded.
Nice.
Which it works out. I mean, I make it work. It's nice to come into town too, because I live about 20 minutes outside of it.
Mm-hmm. So. And come on vacation to your house.
Come on over. I want to know why you started this, Women in Post.
I spent, I feel like a couple months looking for a podcast that was about post-production in general. And then like, I would be super happy if it was other women doing post-production and being on the show. Because in my experience, I've never worked with another female in the field. Like I've only ever worked with men, unless it was an actress. So I guess that never really occurred to me until recently. And then when it did, I started looking on social media to try to see, okay, well, who else is out there that I could relate to, that I could look up to, that I could learn from?
Well, I think it's really cool that you do it because there's not a lot of women out there. I feel like a lot of women just fly under the radar when it comes to this. Because people know Morningstar Films before they know me. And there's been some times when people be like, oh, I had no idea you were a girl. And I'm like, why does that matter? Does that matter? Like, are you not going to hire me because I'm a female filmmaker and I know how the camera works? And I've also noticed, and I don't want it to sound like pretentious or anything, but the amount of men in this industry who approach me about what I do and want to work with me. I had multiple phone calls about people looking for work and wanting me to hire them, and they were all guys. And I was like, interesting. And that's the first time I've ever had to deal with that. Like, just no really other women. I know a couple women filmmakers from a couple groups I'm a part of, but they're just flying under that radar. And I'm like, everyone should be more vocal about what they do, male or female. Mm-hmm. It's such a male-dominated industry that we need to show it's not just Hollywood side where women are trying to break through. It's every day. It's in every town. And the minute I said, you know, I do wedding films, everyone's like, oh, yeah, because you're a girl. I mean, that makes sense. The reality is there's more male wedding filmmakers than there are women wedding filmmakers. And now I'm breaking into this commercial market. I'm really starting to see how male dominated it is. And I'd like to change that. Mm-hmm. And I actually got a friend that I've made here who is a photographer, just a hobby photographer. And I pushed her into filmmaking, and now she's getting work. Because there's such a need. There's such a need for a film. And I always pitch this to every client, is it's you, anybody can go take a picture. Our phones now can compare to a $5,000 camera. It's like anybody can go take a photo, but film is what sets you apart. And they're just like, oh, okay. It's like, you want to take your business seriously, promote it with film and photo, but you want to tell a story quicker and get to the point faster, you need a film. Mm-hmm. Not a picture with words, because everyone scrolls. We're in a scrolling time. Everyone scrolls, and they stop on a movie. They stop on a video on your phone. They don't stop on pictures anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, we're not to the point where that's so saturated that everyone scrolls past that. Mm-hmm. So I tell every business that I talk to pitch, I'm just like, tap this untapped potential right now, because eventually it's going to be too late and you're going to wish you did.
Right.
Which has been great. It's gotten me a lot of business, letting clients know that they are worth it, but you can be worth more than what you appear to be, essentially, with film. It's just, it's a magical, magical thing.
Making magic in the dark.
it's amazing what you can do and how you can make people feel and evoke emotions. And that's why my entire business name, like the premise of it, is what story will you tell? Because I want to know your story, and I want to know how you want the world to see you. Hopefully you want to make a statement, because that's what I'm into, is making statements. What statement do you want to make? And it's always nice to have clients that didn't realize it before, how cool it is, everything that they do, how neat it is, because they're in it every day. It's just like us. We see it every day. So we're just like, yeah, this is the same old, but somebody who doesn't see it, it's just like, that's really cool. Mm-hmm. I'd like to learn that, which is how I picked up an intern on Friday night at a shoot who approached me. The 16-year-old kid was like, that's really cool. Like, are you taking photos or videos? We got to talking, and now his parents want him to come job shadow me.
Oh, that's so cool.
I was like, yeah, come out to some shoots with me. We'll get you rolling on something. Yeah. But it's just those, as people just don't understand the power. And I wish, I'm learning more women that I meet who are in this industry. There's a lot of them who are very open about what they do, and a lot of them who are still too afraid to come forward about what they do. Mm-hmm. Which I'm just trying to promote that you can dominate any industry, male or female. You just have to dominate it. Mm-hmm. That's all it is.
Yes. Let's dominate together.
Yes. Yes, mate. Let's do it. I can't wait to hear all the other women on your podcast who are going to be dominating it.
Yes.
Anybody can find me on Instagram at Morningstar Film Co. Same for Facebook, Morningstar Film Co. My business name is not Film Co. It's Morningstar Films, which you can find morningstarfilmco.com. So yeah, anybody can reach out about anything.
And awesome.
There's some projects. I mean, if anyone's interested in coming to Oregon and they want to come out in a shoot, just reach out and we can go find something to film.
That's amazing. Hey, Ellen, thank you so much for being on the show today and for sharing all your stories. And it's been wonderful.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for watching. I'd love to hear from you. If you enjoyed this week's episode, give us a like, leave us a question or a comment, and share with your friends. Your viewership and support helps promote women working in film. Follow us on Instagram, subscribe to us on YouTube, and join our Patreon community. Interested in being a guest or sponsor on the show? Send me a message. I'd love to hear from you. See you next week on Women in Post.